Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming to this talk on square dance singing calls as part of the MIT IAP session in January of 2013. I see many familiar faces in the audience. I also think I see a few that I may not know quite as well. I know that some of you already know about square dancing and some of you don't, but I'm going to take it from the top and introduce this topic gently. This talk is about issues and techniques for putting square dance singers together specifically. I'm not going to discuss purely musical issues such as composing or arranging, but rather how to take an existing song and then incorporate square dance choreography. And as we will see, this is an interesting, complicated, multidimensional jigsaw puzzle, which is why I delight in it, and I think that some of you might also take an interest in that. So, square dancing is a folk activity. It's a form of dance that goes back hundreds of years, or at least has roots that go back hundreds of years to Europe, and then those dances are brought over to the Americas where they were further transformed. A lot of that transformation happened here in New England, although nowadays we tend to associate here in America square dancing with cowboy music and Western style dancing. And in fact, there are two styles of square dancing that are common nowadays, traditional square dancing, which are very much the forms as they were danced perhaps 80 or 100 years ago. And then there's another form that has evolved in about the last 50 or 60 years called modern Western square dancing. And it is that form that I'm going to be discussing primarily today. That's what I happen to practice, although both forms are still flourish and are equally interesting. And I also want to focus on the fact that modern Western square dancing has evolved a rather complicated language for communicating between a caller, who's someone who tells the dancers what to do, and the dancers who actually execute the movements. There are names for dance actions to be performed. There are names that are used to identify the dancers. There are names that identify geometric formations, and there are names for dance action modifiers. This is actually a kind of programming language for describing the permutations and combinations of eight things on the dance floor. And in fact, if you have many squares on the dance floor, then you have many copies of those eight things. And if you're lucky, all the squares are doing the same thing at the same time. If that's what they want to do. It's really up to the dancers to figure out how they want to have fun. My job as a caller is simply to issue a set of directions that I think will cause the dancers to have fun in time to the music. Now, one of the interesting things about this language is that as time went on during the last 50 years, the square dance language actually got infused with a little bit of computer science in some subtle ways. One of which is that it's now not uncommon for fractions to be introduced, so that you might ask a call to be done 1.5 times, or 1.25 times, or 1 2/3 times. And this requires that the dancers not only know the general dance action, but also understand how it's to be sliced into pieces. Another thing that happens is that there are square dance calls that take other calls as arguments, and requires the dancers to act as little language interpreters in their head while they're dancing. So this adds to some of the mental challenge of the activity. Now, I'm not going to talk about that too much today because those activities, the use of fractions, the use of complicated calls that are nested in together calls as arguments, tends to get used more in the patter form of square dancing. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Whereas this talk is focused mostly on the singers, which tend to be simpler and emphasize more flowing dance action in rhythm to a popular song. So first, to get some terminology under our belts, when the dancers first get together on the dance floor, they get together in groups of eight. There are other forms of dancing that have a caller who issues things to be done, and then the dancers do it. They tend to work into groups of two or four. There's a form, such as the Brazilian casino rueda, involves two-person dancing, and then sometimes the dancers will switch off. And they are doing what the caller says. But in square dancing, we're working in teams of eight. And this form of dancing in particular emphasizes teamwork to an uncommon extent. It's a responsibility of the dancers not only to do what the caller says, but also to help each other carry out the intended dance action. It's a complicated activity. People make mistakes all the time, but a good team will manage to help each other get past those mistakes. Sometimes the callers make mistakes too, and when that happens, we laugh and try to dance our way out of it. The motto is keep on dancing. When a team of eight first gets together on the floor, they're in what is called the home position in a squared set. It's from this we get the name square dancing, because they line up as four couples on the four sides of a square. And then the dancing proceeds from there. And at the end of a dance figure or an entire set of figures, the goal is to get the dancers back to that place where they started in home position, also known as a squared set. During the course of the day, you may hear me tell the dancers to promenade home, or I may say square your sets. These are different directions for getting the dancers to be in their home position. You'll notice that in each couple in this diagram, there is a boy and a girl, marked with a boy standing on the left and girl standing on the right. These are conventional designations. In practice, many dancers dance both parts, regardless of their actual biological gender. I will frequently dance both boy parts and girl parts in the course of an evening at Tech Squares. And we have a set of dancers here who volunteered to demonstrate for us who are dancers at Tech Squares. And you'll notice that four of them are wearing neckties. You can tell which ones of them will be playing the part of a boy as they're actually dancing. And those not wearing neckties will be playing the part of a girl. Another couple pieces of terminology is that when a boy and a girl, or when two dancers in general, are standing side by side, they're sometimes considered to be partners. And you'll hear me say at the beginning, bow to your partner, and they will do that. Then I'll say bow to your corner. Your corner is the person that is adjacent to you across the corner of the square. So for example, the yellow boy at the bottom is the corner of the light blue girl there on the left. And so it is important for dancers to know who their partners are and who their corners are, because directions are given in terms of in those terms. Now, a little more additional terminology before we actually show you some demo dancing. Sometimes it is desirable to break the fourfold symmetry of the square. And in order to do that, you have to have terminology for breaking the symmetry. We usually do that by designating the dancers as heads and sides, and the caller will say, heads do this or sides do that. And that will allow us to get down to twofold symmetry. It is also possible to do completely asymmetric dancing by calling out the numbers of individual couples. There's a system for numbering the couples. I'm not going to use that today, but I wanted to tell you about that. By convention, the heads are the dancers with their backs to the caller or facing the caller, and the others are at the sides of the square. So that you can more easily match dancers to diagrams up there, we're going to use a different convention. We're going to say that today the caller is that fellow on the blackboard over there. And so the heads will be those with their faces to the blackboard or their backs to the blackboard and facing you. During the course of dancing, we will get the dancers into various geometric configurations, and I've illustrated some of them here. They may be in lines of four facing each other. Notice that in order to get them there from the square, I had to break the fourfold symmetry, because facing lines have just twofold symmetry. And one can also have out-facing lines where the dancers are facing out. There are ocean waves where the dancers have alternating directions, in this case a right-hand ocean wave illustrated here in red, where the boys have right hands to the girls and the girls have their left hands connected in the center. There are also left-hand ocean waves, of course. There are other things with esoteric names like quarter tags, Alamo rings, diamonds, which are particularly interesting here, and something called a tidal wave, which is all eight dancers lined up in one long line. And part of the way of achieving variety in choreography is to move the dancers in and out of these various formations. And there are different calls that do that. Okay, so let's have the dancers come up. We'll do a little demonstration of patter. Patter is a kind of free-form style of dancing where the emphasis is perhaps on speed, sometimes on cleverness, on variety in choreography, and the music serves as a background rhythm. We're not necessarily paying attention to the verse structure of music. We're not necessarily paying attention to groups of 16 or 32 or 64 beats. The point is to keep the dancers in motion. And furthermore, a caller will very often improvise the dance moves to be carried out and just make them up as he goes along. And then the caller's responsibility to get people back home when they're supposed to. Because this is a lecture and I want to keep things fairly tight, and I have particular things I want to demonstrate. In fact, I've pre-composed most of my sequences ahead of time and have them on cards here, which I will be reading from. And you'll notice that I print them in 28-point Helvetica bold just to make it that much easier for me to see them. Because gaining even a tenth of a second in grabbing that next thing to do buys me time, which is important in a timed activity such as this. Later on, as we will see, singers have to do more with verse structure and dancing to the tune typically of a popular song. So let's get some music up here. Now, many of you, even if you have not been involved in the modern Western square dance activity, may be familiar with terms such as right and left grand, and alum and left, and do-si-do. Watch for those as I call them here. And the style of music that I'm using here will be a typical Western style song. As we will see later, we use other forms of music as well and other styles of music. So here we go. Bow to the partner in the corner two. Alaman left in the Alamo style and balance. Swing through, go two by two and balance. Swing through. turn back, join hands, circle to the left. Ladies, center in the men's sachet. Ladies, center in the men's sachet. Alaman left, and a right and left grand. On the third hand, you promenade home. Heads pass through, separate, get around one, squeeze in, make a line. Everyone star through, double pass through. Go track two, and swing through. Spin your top. Hinge, coordinate. Couple circulate. Bend that line, pass the ocean. Circulate. Linear cycle. Alaman left, and a right and left grand. Promenade. By the way, dancers, you're being very good so that I can be heard. But I notice that you're being very quiet. Feel free to whoop it up if you want to. It's part of the demonstration. Head start through and spread. Pass through. Do the wheel and deal. Girls in the middle, swing through. Extend. AC doocy. Split, circulate. Scoot back. And the boy run around that girl. Left, touch a quarter. Peel the top. And a right and left through. Go Dixie style. And the boys trade. Alaman left. And a right and left grand. Side square through. Just two. Pass to the center. Double pass through. Put centers in. Cast off three quarters. Slide through. Centers turn through. Left, touch a quarter. Split, circulate. Chain down the line. Flutter wheel. Pass through. Chase to the right. Split, circulate. Follow your neighbor. Alaman left. And a right and left grand. Last one, heads past the ocean. Ping pong circulate. Extend, explode the wave. Do the wheel and deal. Centers pass through and touch a quarter. Scoot back. The boys run. Slide through. Pass through and trade by. And a right and left through. Veer to the left. Girls hinge. Diamond circulate. Flip the diamond, fan the top. Grand swing through, and hinge, column circulate. Boys walk, girls dodge. Trade by, Alaman left. And you bow to the partner, and a corner two. Thanks, dancers, have a seat. Okay, a few things to notice about that. One is that the dancers were doing extraneous things, like clapping their hands and occasionally saying things like quack, twirling, doing extra things that I hadn't necessarily commanded. These are okay, these are called flourishes, and they're part of the fun of square dancing. From a computer science point of view, they also serve as redundancy mechanisms. For example, when I call spin the top, you may hear them say spin the top in echo. Whereas when I say fan the top, they don't. And that helps you to distinguish, boy, what did he say, spin the top or fan the top? And that matters. And so hearing your fellow dancers do the echo gives you an extra clue as to what was going on. The clapping helps you to distinguish one call for another, and so forth and so on. Similarly, there's a beginning and ending protocol. Notice that I began with bow to the partners in the corners too. And I ended with bow to the partners in the corners too. And this is a lovely social courtesy. It also has the advantage of drawing the dancer's attention to who his partner and corner are. So maybe that will stick in the mind better during the course of the dancing sequence. And finally, it serves as a synchronization function. It says, yeah, we're all ready to dance. We all know that we're all ready to dance. And the caller's about to say something else, and now it's really time to start paying attention. So it serves all these various things. And these are similar to the kinds of things that happen in a popular song, where you typically have an intro, and then there's a tag at the end, and then there's stuff in the middle, such as verses. These are not accidents. Okay, so I've demonstrated a pattern for you now, and when we get together to square dance on Tuesday nights at Tech Squares, or at other square dance clubs across the world, typically dancing is divided up into what are called tips for historical reasons. It's speculated that perhaps the caller was given a tip in a tip jar or something at the end of every tip, maybe a nickel if he was good, or nothing if he's lousy. And a tip typically lasts 15 to 20 minutes. A 15-minute tip might have 6 to 7.5 minutes of patter. And then a singer, which typically lasts 3.5 to 4 minutes. And then there'll be a break to, for the dancers to have a rest and to grab a snack, use the restroom, find a new square to dance in, and so forth. In a 20-minute tip, typically the patter becomes longer and the singer stays about the same length. Patter is free-form and often improvised. The music has a good beat but should be relatively unobtrusive. The singer has a more formal structure, and that's what I'm going to talk about during the rest of this talk. So here's a typical singing call structure. Just as a poem might have a standard structure, we know that a limerick has 5 lines. We know that a sonnet has 14 lines, each of five iambic feet and so forth. Well, singing calls have a standard structure too, consisting of an intro and then 7 verses and then a chorus, and each verse is normally 64 beats each. Now, everything I tell you about singing call structure has exceptions. There will be some singing call that varies something on purpose for artistic effect or for other reasons, and we'll examine examples of that later on as well. This is the standard structure that you have to know before you can begin to vary from it. Now, the 7 verses have different functions. Typically, the first one is designated the opener, the fourth one the break, and the last one the closer. And usually, though not always, the choreography for these figures has a fourfold symmetry, and the ladies keep the same partner. So the lady will have the same partner at the end of the figure as at the beginning. Whereas during the verses 2, 3, 5, and 6, these are usually called the figures, and they typically have twofold symmetry in the choreography, although not necessarily. And the other feature is that the ladies may progress. And you use 4 verses of the 7 for this, so that as each lady gets a different partner progressing around the square, by the end of the song, the lady is back with the original partner, and that serves as an error check and also feels socially satisfying. Okay, so now, dancers, if I could have you back up again, please. We're going to do a singing call. And those of you in the audience, I'd like you to notice that this particular singing call is, by intent, quite repetitious, and it's in a very traditional form. The figure will be the same. The choreography will be the same in all 4 of the figure verses. And the structure of the song will be fairly repetitious. And yet, as a matter of style, I will do different things with my singing to provide some amount of variety in there. So let's cue up the next song. Here we go. You bow to the partner in the corner 2. Circle left. You got me. We got something everybody else can see. Left Alaman and a do-side-do. Alaman left and weave around that ring. We don't need no money, honey, you and I. Swinging promenade, oh, money just can't buy what we've got. There's plenty of, I got you, you got me, we got love. Head square through now, 4 hands you go. Round the corner, do-si-do, one time you know. Swing through, and the boy run right. Those couples circulate one time in Ferris wheel tonight. All double pass through, the leader's partner trade the corner swing. You swing and whirl that girl and then you promenade the ring. What we've got, there's plenty of. I got you, you got me, we got love. Head square through, 4 hands you go. Do-si-do the corner once around, you know. Swing through now, and the boy run right. Those couples circulate one time in Ferris wheel tonight. All double pass through, the leader's partner trade the corner swing. You swing that girl around, and then you promenade the ring. What we've got, there's plenty of. I got you, you got me, we got love. Circle left, me. I got you, we got a good thing, honey, you know we do. Left Alaman and a do-si-do. Alaman left and weave around that ring. We don't need no money, honey, you and I. Swing and promenade, oh, money, just get by what we've got. There's plenty of. I got you, you got me, we got love. Side square through now, four hands you go. Do-si-do, once around, you know. Swing through now, the boy run right. Couple circulate and Ferris wheel tonight. All double pass through, the leader's partner trade and corner swing. You swing and whirl that pretty little girl and promenade the ring. What we've got, there's plenty of. I got you, you got me, we got love. Side square through now, four hands you go. Round the corner, do-si-do, one time you know. Swing through now, and the boy run right. Those couples circulate one time in Ferris wheel tonight. All double pass through, the leader's partner trade the corner swing. You swing that girl around, and then you promenade the ring. What we've got, there's plenty of. I got you, you got me, we got love. Circle to the left. I got you. We got a good thing, honey, you know we do. Left Alaman and a do-sa-do. Alaman left and weave around that ring. What we've got together, money just can't buy. Swing and promenade, oh, honey, you and I. What we've got, there's plenty of. I got you, you got me, we got love. And you bow to the partner and the corner too. That's it, you're through. Thank you, dancers. Have a seat. Okay, a couple things to notice about that. As promised, there was a lot of repetition, but I varied it sometimes by changing the melody that I sang, sometimes by changing the wording of what I sang, just something to engage the dancers' interest and make them pay attention a little bit. And it helps, you know, because you do the same thing over and over again. Your mind can go on auto and maybe the right things don't happen. In fact, you may have noticed I glitched slightly on the lyrics in the closing figure. So I quit, oh no. What do I sing? So I reached out and grabbed some words and made it happen. The important thing is to keep the dancing going and make sure the dancers have fun. So mistakes are okay as long as we're having a good time. Now, I'd like to talk a little bit about the history of square dancing. As I said, it's rooted in European dancers, specifically quadrilles that go back to England and France. Henry Ford popularized these in America in the 1920s. He thought that square dancing was an upright and sober thing for people to be doing rather than hanging out in saloons. And indeed, I've got no problem with people drinking, but if you, you know, have three shots and then try to square dance, you know, your timing's probably going to be a little bit off. A fellow named Lloyd Pappy Shaw then popularized square dancing in the 1930s and had a traveling troupe that went out throughout America doing demonstrations. Another thing happened is that with the rise of electric amplifiers, this allows single callers to call to an entire floor. Before then, the practice is that typically either you call to a very small group of people, perhaps two or three squares, or else there would be a different caller in each square, and dancers would want to be in the same square as their favorite caller, and the callers would be dancing. And the dances were usually in prescribed set forms that in principle everybody had memorized, but there are a few people who remembered them better than others and would just call out the, recite the dance figures to the other dancers. They could remember what to do, and these became known as the callers. And with electric amplification, with microphones such as this and speakers, it became possible for one caller to actually control a floor of perhaps 500 dancers. There was then a boom after World War II, and a lot of square dance clubs formed. And soon after this, there was a demand for new variety. Until that point, there were only a few dozen square dance calls, square dance movements, in common use. And callers started inventing new calls in the 1960s. And the other thing that callers figured out how to do about that point was how to sight resolve, which would allow them to do this improvising on the spot, rather than singing and reciting memorized routines. Oh, go away. It's time machine. Okay, there's some interesting historical data. This is the annual attendance of the United States National Square Dance Convention, which typically happens in June. There will be another one this June. And in 2015, it's coming to Springfield, Massachusetts. This will be its first time in New England. But you can see there was a big boom, a rise in the 60s, and it peaked in the mid-70s. There were 40,000 people at the National Square Dance Convention, all there to dance.
Any information about 1976?
Don't have any special information about that, but I will point out that in the 1970s and going into the 1980s, consumer electronics were on the rise. First the VCR, and then and the Walkman, and then other things. And people began staying home and doing less of the social activities involved getting out of the house and being physically with other people. And not only square dancing, square dance convention attendance is somewhat in decline here, well, noticeably in decline, but also things like bowling and ice skating, people where you go out to the rink or the bowling alley, people are doing less of that. You know, and these activities are not dead, but other things have begun to take their place. And this is natural in the course of the evolution of a culture. You know, people try different things for a while, and different generations have the different things they do. And nevertheless, the old ones still hang on, and there are people who like to do that too. So now compare this attendance at the National Square Dance Convention with the number of new square dance calls created every year. And you can see that by that same point in the mid-70s, there was pretty much a new square dance call being invented every day and distributed. And it was hard for dancers to keep up. It was hard for callers to keep up. And there arose these new means of communications, what were called note services, whereby callers exchanged information with each other about the new ideas they'd had. And, you know, here, why don't you try this out at your next dance? You know, my dancers liked it pretty well. And very similar to the role that Martin Gardner played with his column in Scientific American, disseminating mathematical ideas before the rise of the internet made that easier to do and have mathematicians correspond directly with each other. So there were these central clearinghouses, and that's sort of the way information got around in the 60s and 70s. And eventually it reached a point where we had enough of a good thing or too much of a good thing. And the rate of invention of square dance calls declined. That means that the total number of square dance calls continued to grow. So that nowadays we have something like about 5,000 square dance calls cataloged. I'm not sure that any one dancer knows them all. Possibly. But the other thing is that an organization called Caller Lab, which is a professional association of callers, is organized to, among other things, get a handle on this situation, but also to provide other professional services, as much as the Association for Computing Machinery does for computer science, or the American Physical Society does for physicists. Okay, so that's enough for history for now. We'll return to that history a little bit in a few moments, but now I'd like to explain a little bit about what I'd like to call the long calls. Most of the calls we've seen up to now took 2 or 4 or 6 or perhaps at most 8 beats of music to execute. But there are some calls that we like to use in so-called plus dancing, which is the program that we dance at Tech Squares, where some of these calls take as long as 32 beats. Some of them take other numbers of time, 12 beats, 20 beats, 24 beats. And I have not called them yet. So dancers, you can come back up. We're going to demonstrate some of these long calls. And we'll be doing this in the context of complete sequences. And I'm going to do a strange thing here. I'm saying this for the benefit of the dancers as well as the audience. I'm going to call 5 complete figures, but for each one I'm going to use a different piece of music. It's actually unusual to be switching music that way in the middle of a tip. But I want to give you, while you are also looking at these long calls, some sense of the variety of modern music that we use nowadays for doing modern Western square dance. Okay. This will involve a little bit of jiggling of clickers and things on my part, so bear with me. It's fresh this morning on a printer that tends to curl the paper, so let me fix that. And yes, I'm aware that the use of paper in this way makes me a little bit old school. Many callers would have all this material on a laptop and call it that way. My laptop is busy, I didn't want to have 2 laptops out of it, but anyway, I'm using paper. And dancers, here we go. Bow to the partner in the corner two. Walk around your corner. Back to the partner. Do passo. Head lady center for the teacup chain. This is a 32 beat call. Rather intricate, very pretty. You're wasting time for a moment. Face your partner, do passo. Side lady center for the teacup chain. Notice at the beginning I call head ladies or side ladies that breaks the fourfold symmetry. Balam and left, and a right and left grand. Beat your own, you promenade home. Heads pass through. Separate a round two. Look on the ends, make a line. Box the ganat, and a right and left through. Load the boat. This is a 12 beat call. Star through, pass through, bend the line, load the boat. The centers are doing one thing and the ends are walking round and round. And a right and left through. Palaman left, and a right and left grand. Meet your own, you promenade home. Sides lead to the right and veer to the left. Couples circulate. Chain down that line. Pass the ocean. Spin chain the gears. Notice the dark dancers of four stars of four and are turning them. Those are the gears. Linear cycle. Pass through. Do the wheel and deal. Double pass through. Go track two. Spin chain the gears. The gears are turning. Box the net. And a right and left grand on the third hand you promenade. Side square through four. Slide through, and a right and left through. Go Dixie style, an ocean wave. Trade that wave. Spin chain and exchange the gears. See the gears forming, but now they're going to trade places like that. Spin your top. Grand swing through. And hinge, coordinate. Ferris wheel, double pass through, and cloverleaf. Centers pass through, spin chain and exchange the gears. Who's leading? There's the exchange. And spin your top. Explode the wave, and a right and left grand. Last one, heads promenade halfway. Come down the middle and pass the ocean. Extend, relay the deucey. Explode and touch a quarter. Coordinate. Half tag, scoot back. In the center's trade. Split circulate. Swing through. Relay the deucey. Notice the long wave and people chain up and down it. They call 646 to help them keep it straight. Swing through. All eight circulate. And a right and left grand. And you bow to the partner in the corner. corner two. Dancers, stay where you are. I'll need you in just a moment. Okay, I'd like to talk a little about tempo and rhythm now. As for all dancing, it's desirable to have a steady beat, and it's not unusual, of course, for popular songs that you, I was about to say hear on the radio, that you hear by whatever medium you hear them nowadays. It's okay, I am what I am. You know, but as popular music comes out, one thing at a time, you see it on Dancing for the Stars or American Idol. That popular song, sometimes its beat is not quite steady, perhaps there is artistic rubato in it, and the voice varies, but it will be remixed as a dance remix, and the beat will be made rock steady, will be given a strong drum beat beneath it, to make it easier for dancers to hear where their footsteps are supposed to fall. For square dancing, for modern Western square dancing, the typical tempo is between 120 and 132 beats per minute. If a popular song is at 112 beats per minute, perhaps it can be sped up a little bit. If it's at 143, we can slow it down a little bit. If it's 90, that's really hard. Probably won't try to turn that into square dance music. So at a speed of 120 beats per minute times 7 verses times 64 beats per verse, that works out to 3.5 minutes exactly. And then, of course, you can fudge it from there by putting the tempo up or down, and of course the intro and the tag add a little bit of time too, and that's why we typically budget about 4 minutes for a singer. Typical rhythms are 2-4 or 4-4, but it's also possible to use a swung rhythm or even 6-8 rhythm. And I have an example of that I would like to show you. Okay, we will not be dancing to this music quite yet, dancers. Instead, I'm going to demonstrate this song, which is as originally recorded by Rod Stewart. Okay. So that was really nice, and in typical Rod Stewart style, his voice is kind of wandering back and forth, his tempo is wandering back and forth across the nice steady beat of the drum, and that's a little bit slow for square dancing. So here is how we turn it into a square dance singer, and now dancers, you may get ready. Bow to the partner. Ladies chain, you turn that girl around now, you roll away and circle left. Four ladies roll away, you circle to the left now, Alaman left, and then you weave around the ring. The rhythm of my heart is beating like a drum. Swing the girl around and promenade. Never will I roam, for I know my place is home. Where the ocean meets the sky, I'll be sailing. It's promenade, it's halfway round you travel. Walk in and pass the ocean here. Extend, spin chain through. Girls circulate, go twice. You'll meet your partner, you turn through and then left Alaman, the corner girl. Walk right by your own. Swing the next around and promenade. Never will I roam, for I know my place is home. Where the ocean meets the sky, I'll be sailing. It's promenade, it's halfway round you travel. Walk in and pass the ocean here. Extend, spin chain through. Girl, circulate, go two times. Meet your partner, you turn through and then left Alaman, the corner girl. Walk right by your own. Swing the next around and promenade. Never will I roam, for I know my place is home. Where the ocean meets the sky, I'll be sailing. Four ladies chain, you turn that girl now, and roll away and circle left. Four ladies roll away, you circle to the left now. Alaman left, and then you weave around that ring. The rhythm of my heart is beating like a drum. The words I love you rolling off my tongue. Never will I roam, for I know my place is home. Where the ocean meets the sky, I'll be sailing. Four ladies chain, and square your steps that way, please, dancers. Okay, I did just half the singer that time to save a little bit of time. A couple things to notice about that. One is that it was a right-hand lady's progression, and when I called the first figure, you may have noticed the dancers hesitate just a minute. Is this really my corner? No, it's not your corner, and I intended that. Instead, I was moving the ladies the other way around the square. Again, that's a kind of choreographic variety you can introduce. Sorry I didn't warn you, dancers, but I knew you could do it. Callers and dancers have a good relationship. You know, we play games with each other. You can even tell jokes in the square dancing language. I'm not going to try much of that today. Not much. Another thing to point, I want to point out about the square dance language is that I seem to be directing a lot of my comments to the boys. I said, you know, walk, you know, Alan, I left your corner, swing the corner girl, walk right by your own, swing the next round. Yeah, walk right by your own, swing the next round. Very often it's a part of the syntax of the square dance language that calls will be directed to the boys. Not that the girls are any less involved, but if you say, well, boys do this, girls do that, you don't have time to say that. And maybe there is some social reason why we tell the boys quite specifically what to do rather than the girls, I'll let you speculate on that. But it is a grammatical peculiarity of language that many times the caller will seem to be addressing the boys, whereas, in fact, everybody has to be paying attention. Okay, now I'd like to talk a little bit about the structure of the singing call verse. And we'll be having another, stay up dancers, we'll be having another singer in just a moment. I showed you the breakdown of a singing call into 7 verses. Each verse, in turn, having 64 beats, can be broken down into 8 lines of 8 beats each. And a typical structure for singing call verse is to spend the first 40 beats doing various dance calls. And if possible, lyrics of the song may be woven in there, possibly. But the important thing is to keep the dancing going. By about the 6th line, it's time to swing and promenade, and that promenade will take the last 2 lines. That's an opportunity to sneak in some of the lyrics of the song. So that means that overall, the structure of singing call can be broken down like this, and this is the kind of chart that I use often when I am trying to choreograph a singing call. I'll literally make a chart like this and start penciling in lyrics and penciling in square dance calls and so forth, and we'll see this in more detail in a moment. So we have the opener, 2 figures, a break, 2 figures, and a closer. Each has 8 lines of 8 beats each. Now we've got issues as to how to place lyrics and how to place calls. For figures, which are verses 2, 3, 5, and 7, we usually want to fill up at least the first 32 beats, if not the first 40 beats, with calls. Sometimes you can sneak lyrics into beats 33 through 40, as shown in the 3rd column there. You need swing and promenade in the 6th line, and then you've got an opportunity for lyrics, or you've got an opportunity to just shut up and let the dancers enjoy the music, and that's an aesthetic choice to be made. As for the opener, the break, and the closer, that may also have that structure where the first 32 beats are filled up with stuff, as in the last singer when I said, 4 ladies chain, turn the girls, roll them away, circle left, roll away, Alouette left, weave the ring. So I spent that first 32 beats just issuing calls. But that's also an opportune place to stick in some lyrics. And that can be done in several patterns. And in the extreme case, there are a few ways of using the long calls, so I can just spend nearly the entire 64 beats singing lyrics. And sometimes you want to do that. For example, I might begin with a sides face grand square. That keeps the dancers dizzy for 32 beats, so I can sing whatever I want to. Then I throw in Alouette left and weave the ring. They know what to do from there. They know the swing and promenade is implied. And I can just sing to my heart's content, if I think they will enjoy that. Or if I think I will enjoy that. Okay, so now I'm going to work in some detail on a fairly specific example. This is a song called On and On. It goes, down in Jamaica they got lots of pretty women. They'll steal your money and they'll break your heart. And like that. Okay, so it's this Caribbean song, steel pan, steel drums, and